Hello everyone, welcome to Rasayan Academy. And guys, you already know that we are doing a series of 100 name reactions. So what I have thought this time is to provide you name reactions in such a manner so that you can compare two of these similar name reactions and you will be able to remember them nicely. So what I have done is I have made a series of, I will make a series of name reactions. One video is going to have more than two name reactions which are very, very similar, so that remembering them would be very easy. And also in this particular series, within the 100 name reaction series, that is the most important name reactions right now for your upcoming CSIR examination. So I will be posting some very, very important name reactions which I think are important this time. So the first of all, what we are going to discuss today is the Kore-Kim oxidation. And if you have noticed the previous year question papers, you will see the other Kore reactions, that is the Kore-Chekhovsky reaction. Very many times it has been asked. Then you have the Kore-Fuchs reaction. Then you have this time Kore-Winter olefination was asked, right, in December 19. So I think that Kore-Kim oxidation is also a very good reaction. I think that this time it might come since it has not been asked in your any of the CSIR examination. Okay, so we are going to talk about the Kore-Kim oxidation. It is very similar to the Swern oxidation that we have already seen. So we have already talked about the Swern oxidation. I will paste the link of the video right over here. Okay, so the Swern oxidation uses COCl2 oxalyl chloride and DMSO. Alright, in the first step, it is a two-step reaction, right? Then in the second step, you use the triethyl amine, or basically a base, right, to do the elimination and so on. So Swern oxidation, Kore-Kim oxidation and Moffat oxidation, these three reactions are very similar. Just a change of the reagent combination, and the work is the same from the alcohol to ketone. Okay, so it could be your primary alcohol that will give you aldehyde, it could be your secondary alcohol that gives you ketone. Okay, so very similar reactions, and I think that probability this time is very high, either in your CSIR examination or in your GATE examination, Kore-Kim oxidation. So let's try and study it very quickly. So first of all, what is the Kore-Kim oxidation? Let's see. Oxidation of alcohols to the corresponding aldehyde or ketone using NCS-DMS. Now, what is NCS-DMS followed by treatment with a base? So it is N-chlorosuccinimide that we are talking about. So it is N-chlorosuccinimide. Okay. N-chlorosuccinimide, and along with you have dimethyl sulfide, which is also used over here, dimethyl sulfide. Okay, so NCS, DMS, these are guys very, very simple reagents which are given over here. And then in the second step, you once again have the triethyl amine. So if you study the Swern oxidation mechanism side by side, if you study Kore-Kim oxidation, it would be very easy to remember. Why? Let me show you through the mechanism. So in your Swern oxidation, why were you actually using the oxalyl chloride to basically, then you also had DMSO along with this. So there's an oxygen above, okay? Yes, so you have an oxygen like this. So basically to generate the sulfur electrophile, to make the oxygen of the alcohol attack on the sulfur, generate the sulfur electrophile. And using the triethyl amine, we were removing a proton of one of these carbons, then gives the oxidation. Same thing we are doing over here, just a little bit of difference. So first of all, what is the first step? First step is that your NCS, N-chlorosuccinimide, is being attacked by the DMS, dimethyl sulfide, like this. So it attacks on chlorine, negative charge comes on nitrogen since it is more electronegative. Now, since you have generated another electrophile, nitrogen attacks over sulfur, removes the Cl minus, and this is what you get. This is just the intermediate. Okay, so sulfur becomes a good electrophilic position for the alcohol oxygen to attack, and that is what it is doing. Oxygen is attacking on sulfur, opening up this bond, if the nitrogen bond opens up, nitrogen is going to take away this proton, proton is going to fall off, and then further you have this oxygen sulfur bond formation. So this is the key step that we wanted to prepare, and the same intermediate you are getting in all of these oxidations, because now in the second step there is going to be triethyl amine. You have two methyl groups over here, so you know the same thing is happening in all of these three reactions, just that the formation of this intermediate is given by three different reagents, just that. And two of these reactions are two step, and the Moffat oxidation is one step reaction. So let's see, here you have triethyl amine. Now many of you might do this mistake, let me point out, many of you might also get stuck on this, which you must not. That is, since it is an oxidation reaction, you might think, okay, the triethyl amine is removing an acidic proton, this is also an acidic proton, because if it eliminates, you are going to get the ketone. You might also draw the mechanism in this manner, but it is completely wrong. It is not how it is happening. First of all, the triethyl amine is removing the proton connected to this sulfur, the positive sulfur. This is more electronegative, more acidic proton. Okay, and then when it forms a molecule or an intermediate like the sulfur elide, okay, now the CH2 minus is intramolecularly taking away a proton and giving the oxidation like this. Okay, so be careful about this. All right, and this is what you have to remember about in all of these reactions. Okay, so very important reaction and also very easy to do. You have formed your ketone, and what is the byproduct? Byproduct is once again DMS. So a question might come like this, that what is the major product of the following reaction? Or a question might also ask you that what is the byproduct of the Kohr-Akim oxidation, Swan oxidation, Moffat oxidation, all right, like that. Okay, so the byproduct is once again DMS. So as you can see, we started with DMS and we end up with DMS as well in the Kohr-Akim oxidation. And we started with N-chlorosuccinimide, and finally it is just going to be the amide like this, not chloro. It is going to be normal succinimide. Okay, this is what you get. And yes, you have oxidation of your alcohol. Now this is once again a two-step reaction. In the first step you have this combination, then at a lower temperature only you are adding the triethyl amine. So this reaction is carried out at lower temperatures. Now guys, we see one example, very important example we see over here. So I think that once again you must stop the video and do this by yourself. Okay, so what do you have? You have 0.5 equivalent, that is catalytic amount of NCS. Very well, now you don't have DMS this time. DMS is dimethyl sulfide. You don't have that, you just have a much more bigger sulfide. Okay, but you will be able to figure out, right, the mechanism. So what happens is, yes, the sulfur is going to attack on the nitrogen in the same manner like this. Okay, and what happens is it is going to get connected to nitrogen, then there is going to be further oxygen attacking over sulfur. So what I'm directly writing is, let me just directly write what is going to be the intermediate which we need to worry about. Since you have already written done the mechanism, hopefully you have written it down as well. So since you have already written the mechanism, this is what you are going to have: a lot many number of methylene groups, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and so on. So yes, you have the 6 member ring like this. Okay, so ultimately you still have a positive charge on sulfur, then your triethyl amine is going to remove a proton right from here. Triethyl amine is going to remove a proton from here. You get a negative charge. Negative charge is going to internally, or let's say intramolecularly, it is going to grab the deuterium. So I'm just directly writing that this is CH2 minus, and this side it is going to be a long chain. Okay, so hence it is, the reaction is like this. You had a positive charge. Now the molecule is as it is regenerated. It is just there to remove the proton. It is going to be regenerated. All right. And yes, your answer is going to be like this. So you have this ketone. You have this ketone right over here. And the deuterium is removed and taken away by the methyl group over here, right? Like, so basically this is just also a proof of that of this mechanism, that if you think that the molecule is completely regenerated, how are you going to say that this elide has formed, or the elide like intermediate has formed, and your and your base is not directly taking away this proton? How would you confirm that? You would confirm from a mechanism, or let's say an example like this. Okay, so these are very, very important mechanisms. Now guys, hopefully you have correlated what is the difference between the Swern oxidation and the Kore-Kim oxidation. Now we move onwards to the Moffat oxidation. So once again, very, very similar mechanism. Let's see. Oxidation of alcohols using BCC and DMSO once again. So basically what is happening is you are having BCC and DMSO this time. So DMSO is common in both of the Moffat oxidation as well as the Swern oxidation also. DMSO is common in both of them. Here you have DCC. In the Swern oxidation you have the oxalyl chloride, like this. Okay, just that difference. And now it is also known as the Fisner-Moffat oxidation. All right, so if you just remember one name, that will be all. Okay, so yes, here we are guys, we have a secondary alcohol over here in the presence of DCC, DMSO, and do you observe there is no base in this reaction? It is just an acid. Okay, just an acid, there is no base, and also this is a one-step reaction. Moffat oxidation is a variant, and it is just a one-step reaction. You don't require the reaction to happen in two steps, and the base also you don't require. Let's discuss how. So getting the same ketone once again, DCC is 1,3-dicyclohexyl carbodiimide. Okay, it's not amide, it is imide. So dicyclohexyl carbodiimide, this is what you have, and DMSO you know already, dimethyl sulfoxide. Very well. So the thing is, I will be writing this as CY. Okay, cyclohexyl. So let's move onwards and see the mechanism very quickly. So the mechanism goes like this guys, that first of all, so ultimately I think that by studying these two reactions, the Swern oxidation and the Kore-Kim oxidation, you finally know that the alcohol oxygen has to attack over the sulfur. Okay, this you must have got already. So if we look onto DCC in the Moffat oxidation, or if we look at NCS, or if we look at oxalyl chloride, so they are basically just generating the sulfur electrophile. Okay, all right, so let's see what is happening over here. So you have DMSO. Yes, you have DMSO. So DMSO is going to alright, so I've already written it over here. So first of all, the nitrogen is getting protonated because you have an acid, you have DCC, you have DMSO. So let's say the nitrogen got protonated like this. Alright, got a positive charge. So the oxygen of the DMSO attacks over this carbon, relieves the positive charge on nitrogen, and you have a molecule right like this. So oxygen of the DMSO connected to the carbon of the DCC. Okay. Yes, very well. Now guys, what we see is that you don't have a base in the molecule, and again this is your alcohol which you want to oxidize. So the alcohol is going to once again attack on the sulfur. Okay, like always, like in the other reactions that we have studied. So it is attacking onto the sulfur. This bond is going to open up, and yes, one more proton abstracted by the acid HX that you have. It could be anything. It could be acetic acid or any acid, right? So yes, here is what you have got. You have basically dicyclohexyl urea, isn't it? It is dicyclohexyl urea. Okay, yes. You, I think, can also call it DCU. It is dicyclohexyl urea. That is the byproduct. This is the byproduct. And further, this is the same intermediate that we generated in the all of these three reactions. Now the X minus part. So you don't have a base. No external base is required. We don't have a base, right? The triethyl amine to remove the proton from one of the methyls connected to sulfur. What we have is we just have the X minus. Okay, the remaining part of the acid. It removes a proton from here. Alright, so why is this happening? Because first of all, we have a weak acid which is readily able to grab the proton because it has a strong conjugate base. Secondly, the proton itself is highly acidic because it is connected to a sulfur which is electropositive. Okay, yes, so this is what you have got. And now CH2 minus attacks internally, and the same mechanism is going to be followed to give you finally the ketone. So hopefully you have understood, everyone, that the reaction is the same. Okay, after forming this intermediate, it's the same thing, just that you need different combinations to get to this intermediate right over here. All right, so yes, now we are going to see an example very, very quickly. DCC, DMSO. All right, so here is what you have, DCC and DMSO. And you have an acid that is your dichloroacetic acid, basically. Okay, so again, try and draw the mechanism by yourself. A is another group, let's say it is adenosine or any other group. Basically, in this reaction, it is adenosine only. All right, so let's say you have a molecule in this manner. So, first of all, guys, what are you going to generate with DCC and DMSO? Just now, we have seen the mechanism. You are going to generate this intermediate, basically, just that. Okay, you are generating this intermediate. Then what happens is you have the remainder part, Cl2CHCOO minus. You have the remaining part of whatever acid you are using, the conjugate base, which is, for example, going to grab a proton, and that gives you the conjugate base, right, like this. Okay, and hence the oxidation will be proceeded. So you have a CH2 oxygen. Sulfur now has a CH2 minus CH3. So this proton is taken away and you get the formation of the aldehyde, right, like this. Okay, this is how you get the aldehyde formation from the Moffat oxidation. So you could also carry out this reaction from Kohr-Akim oxidation as well. The Moffat oxidation is a one-step reaction, and that is why it is better than the Kohr-Akim oxidation. But yes, once again, why are we doing this? Because I strongly feel that in your upcoming exam, you are going to get Kohr-Akim oxidation. It may be in your CSIR or GATE exam, because most of the Kohr-Akim reactions are done. Alright, and I will also be posting the other Kohr-Akim reaction. Kohr-Akim-Chekhovsky reaction I have already posted. If you want, you can check it out. Okay, and guys, also give your reviews. Yes, so also I need to ask your suggestions based on if you are liking this idea that posting two similar name reactions together. See, your reactions are completed. Okay, I'm not missing out on anything. I am going to make it 100 name reactions for you. Okay, but it will be easier for you to remember and to be able to make a link between what is different, between different or similar in between two or more name reactions. Okay, so when you study Swern oxidation, you also study Kohr-Akim oxidation, you also study Moffat oxidation, because all of these three are same. All right, just a similar mechanism, different reagents, and the same work as well. Okay, so try and follow the other name reaction videos as well, and if you are liking this, then also please comment, and I will also share the link of the important and related videos. And guys, yes, don't forget to follow on Unacademy. I know that you are watching all the special classes, which is really good, and I appreciate that you are working hard for your knowledge. But also follow, guys, because without following you won't get timely updates and regular notifications basically. And yes, if you're liking the content good enough, then you can join me on Unacademy Plus. We are starting new session from December 2020 because we have time, right? So you can use this code Jagriti, yes, that gives you a 10% discount on the Unacademy Plus platform. Okay, so we'll see you very, very soon in another name reaction video. Till then, bye. Have a nice day.